Hello, good afternoon to all. Welcome here. Welcome to the panel. We will introduce them in a little bit. I'm Ana Cecilia Mendez from Telemundo 40. I will do this very first part in Spanish. It's better for me. Bienvenidos a este día. Esta tarde estaremos hablando sobre reforma migratoria y sobre los temas más importantes en nuestra comunidad en relación a inmigración y cómo afecta nuestras comunidades. Now I will continue in English. Good afternoon and welcome to the distinguished panel that we have here. We're going to know a little bit of them in their own words and a little bit that we'll all see in a minute. Here today, thanks first of all to TSC for put everything together to have all us here today. Welcome to this distinguished speaker series and talk about immigration reform, featuring today Dr. Tony Zavaleta, who is going to talk about how the kids that are going to the border and unaccompanied immigrant children and families are going to be here and how that affects our community. But first of all, for the opening remarks, we are going to welcome Dr. Brian McCormer, instructor of history and chair of business and social sciences.
Good evening, everyone. I was asked to make a few opening remarks about our topic today, and so I wrote down some comments, and after I trimmed them down from 20 minutes, I'll try to get them down to five. But so I'm going to just talk about the history of the immigration issue a little bit, and what I'm going to refer to is what I call the emergence of the federal immigration and citizenship regime, which I mean basically the structure that's in place today that Dr. Zavaleta is going to be kind of speaking with in more detail. So let's talk about immigration as we conceptualize it, how we often romanticize the topic. There's a famous play that many people have heard the name of, written in 1908, and it's called The Melting Pot. It was written by Israel Zangwill, and it celebrates the United States as this exceptional country that absorbed immigrants from around the world. And we often celebrate our country as a model for absorbing immigrants and our citizenship laws that make it relatively easy, people argue, to become a citizen. And what I noticed when I look at the topic of immigration is, while we have been a very open country in terms of our immigration policies relative to a lot of other countries, our citizenship policies have historically fallen far short of our ideals. In fact, the United States has an impressive history of imposing strict limits on immigrants, the kind of immigrants we accept into the country. We have excluded immigrants on a variety of different grounds, including national origin, race, religion, health, sexuality, economic standing, political ideology, more recently on the basis of perceived criminal, even lately terrorist background. And so we have imposed quite a range of limitations on who we accept, who we welcome, who we exclude. And often these attitudes reflect deeper attitudes about who we believe are desirable immigrants and who we perceive to be undesirable immigrants. And in fact, I think you can look at immigration policy as a mirror into how Americans perceive and want to define themselves. So the immigration system, in some respects, gets its start from Article 1, Section 8 of the U.S. Constitution, and that section of the Constitution confers on the federal government the powers to establish a uniform rule of naturalization. Okay, so what does that mean? It means, at least as it was interpreted after the American Revolution, that the federal government tried to assume the role of serving as the tool through which immigration policy was established. But the states necessarily didn't always see it that way. In fact, the states tried to fight a lot of different elements of federal immigration and naturalization policies. But nonetheless, going all the way back to the naturalization law of 1790, that law basically extended the privilege of citizenship or naturalization to the basis or on the basis of free white person. So you had to be basically a free white person to basically be naturalized as a U.S. citizen. Immigration restriction, including policies to design and limit immigration and establish citizenship rights oftentimes remained in the hands of the states. So a lot of this history, when we look at immigration, coincides with many of the things we understand about U.S. history, but we don't really perceive them to be about really the broader theme of immigration. So when we look at immigration and naturalization policy, for example, we see that states often imposed different conditions on who could become a citizen or who was defined as a citizen. So in the early period after the American Revolution and the early decades of the 1800s, Native Americans, women, in many cases African Americans, were excluded from citizenship. And it was often done on a state-by-state basis and how they imposed these limits. Sometimes states even limited based on your socioeconomic standing as well. So there are all kinds of policy states used to exclude people and actually deport people. And the most famous and really first case of deportation in American history is a case we all are familiar with, and that was the Cherokee removal in the Trail of Tears in 1838. We don't think of it as a deportation, but it really was a state deportation practice and policy. So we can kind of trace all this throughout the 1840s and 50s. We can go up to the Civil War, and we see a dramatic shift. And that occurs with really the passage of the 14th Amendment, which is going to dramatically expand the powers of the federal government. And this is going to have a very important impact on immigration and citizenship law. Many of you probably know that the 14th Amendment made everyone basically born in the United States a citizen, or if you were naturalized in the United States, you were basically a U.S. citizen under that amendment. And states basically lost some of the certain privileges they had. So after the 14th Amendment is basically put into effect, it becomes basically the law of the land, states begin to lose some of the powers they used to have. And so in many respects, we begin to see what I call the modern federal immigration and citizenship regime, the government structure that establishes immigration policy, enforces immigration policy. So we think of that as basically not only the legal components of it, but all the institutions that are involved in basically enforcing immigration policy as well. So this really begins to kind of take shape after the passage of the 14th Amendment, especially in the 1880s and 1890s, when we see large numbers of immigrants coming from Europe and Asia, and we begin to see a rise of anti-immigrant sentiment, first targeting Chinese and other Asian immigrants. So we'll see the passage of acts trying to restrict prevent Asians from becoming citizens, and eventually, first Chinese, and then eventually Asians from actually even immigrating to the United States. We also see in 1907 an act passed called the Immigration Act of 1907, which basically was the first time if you wanted to come to the United States as an immigrant, you had to pass through an official port of entry. So that's kind of interesting because we're beginning to see now the federal government assume this more expansive role. In the 1920s, with the rise of scientific racism, we'll see the rise of the quota system under the National Origins Act. And that simultaneously is going to take shape alongside the development of the Border Patrol, which is created in 1924. So 1924, we see the first time an institution created that actually is designed, a federal agency designed to enforce immigration restrictions and policies in the country. So the interesting thing about all this is it really didn't apply to people from the Americas. Most of the quota system that was put in place basically applied to Europeans. And so if you were coming from Mexico, you really didn't have any limit on coming into the country at that time. And that was basically done because a lot of the ranchers and agribusiness in the Southwest needed labor, and they didn't want to see any kind of restrictions on that. But it was a kind of double-edged sword because you'll see that it created a lot of fear and racism in the Southwest, generated that, and that gave rise to different ways the government, sometimes ingenious ways, developed to try to deport people from the Southwest, Mexicans and other immigrants. And so they used terms like likely to become a public charge. That happened in the 1930s, so during the Great Depression. Okay. After World War II, we see a big expansion in this the role of the federal government in immigration, and I think that gets us a lot to where we're going to be today, talking about some of the issues that Dr. Zavaleta is going to speak about. Some of you may have heard of the Bracero program, where a lot of Mexican workers came in to help the United States during World War II because of a vast labor shortage. And that was one way in which labor policy and immigration policy kind of came together. And again, like the double-edged sword I spoke about earlier, a lot of times this led to problems. One of the problems it created was the fact that under the Bracero program, the Mexican government basically tried to protect the wages and negotiated contracts for Mexican labor, and a lot of the people who hired them thought it was too expensive, so they tried to go around the back of this Bracero contract labor program and created a situation where even the Immigration and Naturalization Service was basically turning the other way as undocumented immigrants came into the country. It led to a program called Operation Wetback in the 1950s, 1954, when about 1 to 2 million immigrants from Mexico were deported. So I want you to kind of see this kind of give and take that takes place over this period, and how the immigration policies kind of ebb and flow and reflect a lot of the different themes of American history. But one theme seems constant throughout it all is that's basically the tremendous expansion of the role of the federal government during this period and the creation of this federal immigration enforcement regime. So we see that most clearly, and it kind of gets us to where we are today in the 1960s. 1950s and 1960s, we see the civil rights movement influencing immigration policy. They get rid of some of the restrictions on national origin, the quota system based on, you know, what country you're from. They kind of try to balance it out so it doesn't privilege Western European countries. And that sounds all fine and good, but what we'll find out is it also occurs alongside a tremendous expansion in the powers of the federal government to enforce immigration restriction. So one act called the McCarran-Walter Act in 1952, for example, one of the acts that got kind of undid some of these quotas. It expanded the powers of the government to apprehend and deport undocumented immigrants, empowering immigration agents to conduct without warrant searches of railway cars, aircrafts, vehicles, and vehicles that were within a reasonable distance of the border, even the search of private lands within 25 miles of the border. Trying to balance the immigration policy, make it less racist, I guess you could say, in terms of its application, but at the same time, implementing policies that greatly expanded the role of the state. So to wrap things up, the history we're going to hear about today and the story we're going to hear today in the discussion really reflects the broader theme of a long history of immigrants coming into the country over our history. And what I would leave you with is the fact that the immigrants coming into the country today are following a path that in many respects follow the paths of many ghosts, immigrants who came to our country over the last couple hundred years. So with that, I'll move on to the next speaker. Thank you.
Thank you so much again to Dr. Brian McCormack, Instructor of History and Chair of Business and Social Sciences Department in TSC. Now we are going to go with the featured speaker tonight, Dr. Tony Zavaleta. Dr. Tony Zavaleta grew up in Brownsville and is member of one of the 13 founding families of Northern Mexico. He's the nephew of Dr. Joe Zavaleta and Prax Oribe, each of whom served on the TSC TSC board. Dr. Zavaleta graduated from St. Joseph Academy in 1964 and entered Texas Southmost College, graduating and transferring to the University of Texas at Austin in 1966, where he completed a PhD in anthropology in 1976. Moving back to Brownsville in 1976, Dr. Zavaleta began teaching sociology and anthropology at Texas Southmost College and at Pan American University at Brownsville. Dr. Zavaleta became the first dean of the College of Liberal Arts for UTV and TSC, and also served as the dean of the College of Mathematics and Science and Technology. He next served as vice president for partnership affairs, where he coordinated all of the work between the TSC board and UTV, and then became the vice president for external affairs, which included governmental relations and all external programs such as workforce training and continuing education. Dr. Zavaleta served as interim provost, the chief operating officer of UTV TSC, and then as the associate provost and vice president for academic affairs. In 2011, he retired from the administration to return to full-time teaching. Dr. Zavaleta retired in May 2016 after 40 years of service. Dr. Zavaleta is regarded as one of the top experts on the U.S.-Mexico border and frequently speaks throughout Mexico and the U.S. Dr. Zavaleta was appointed to two federal commissions by Presidents Reagan and Obama, and he served two terms on the Brownsville City Commission, followed by a term on the City of Brownsville Civil Service Commission. Now, let's give him a big round of applause for our featured speaker tonight.
It feels like you've already been here for an eternity, right? Listen, there's no need for anybody to stand up. There's lots of seats down here in front. They say reserved. Ignore that. Please come and get a seat. You know, there's no need for you to stand. Huh? Not going to take me up on that offer? Okay. Listen, let me tell you how honored I am to be, I had nothing to do with it, how honored I am to be chosen to speak to you about this very, very, very important topic. I've done several interviews with the media, and probably will do a couple more, and I've told them, and they asked me, well, what's important about this presentation? And I think, well, there are many things that are important about it, but the most important thing about it is that you, for the most part, the average citizen, the average student, you don't know about these issues. You don't know about, you hear on the news, you may read the article in the paper, you probably don't, but you might read the article about unaccompanied children, or the Beast Train, or La Mara Salvatrucha. I mean, you know, unless you have specific interests or professors talking about those topics, those are not things that you're interested in, and you're not going to ever know about them, but they're important. And so my purpose here today is to talk about those, the importance of these topics. My pattern of teaching, I try to always over-prepare, and I'm way over-prepared right now. In fact, I have 50 pages of notes, not including the PowerPoint presentation. So I'm not gonna make you suffer through all that. I'm gonna try to go through it as quickly as I can. This is important for you to note that all of the information that I'm presenting to you this afternoon is online. Okay, it's all online. You can discover it all. I think I've read more than 100 monographs, articles, books in the last couple of months preparing for this presentation. If this is something that interests you to do a term paper or something like that, it's all there for you. Also, the photographs. I don't claim to have taken any. This is important from an academic point of view. These photographs, like the one you see right there, these are all online. That happens to be a Breitbart photograph, I believe. So I wanted to, it was important for me to say that to you, to tell that to you in preparing for this presentation. There's also a couple of other caveats. I haven't started yet, okay? This is the I haven't started. The statistics on immigration are highly variable. And even when you read articles by different journalists from different newspapers or magazines or reporting about the same thing, but they have different numbers. So I want you to know that. They're highly variable, and I've tried to select only those numbers that I consider to be the most reliable. Also, it's not clear to me whether or not some of these numbers are duplicated. So they might say that 56,000 unaccompanied children crossed the border in 2014, and another 17,000 families with children, but they don't tell us whether that 17,000 is a part of that 56,000. The numbers are huge, but that's something that I'm not clear about. It's also important to note that apprehension numbers, and this is the way the term apprehension is very offensive. I honor my colleagues and I welcome you all here to be here with me. The term apprehension is very offensive, but that's the term, that's the official government term that is used. They talk about 56,000 unaccompanied children were apprehended. Well, they weren't apprehended. They gave themselves up. They crossed the border and walked right up to the nearest immigration official and said, I claim refuge. I'm a refugee. They give them in Central America where they start, and some kids have tattoos of their uncle or their mother or their father's telephone number in Chicago so that they won't forget it and they won't lose it. And they also, and they've been trained, there's something that I'll talk to you about. They've been trained to upon apprehension, and when they first encounter a federal official, to ask for refuge in the United States, which puts them into a totally different category than being apprehended. And I think you need to know that. We need to understand that. Another thing is, I'm going to be talking about colonias a little bit. And I want you to know that the numbers of people that reside in our colonias, and we have literally hundreds of colonias in the valley. There's 100 just in Cameron County, probably another 150 or more in Hidalgo County. The numbers that we have for the population of people that live in colonias is an undercount. I was fortunate to serve as the chairman of the, for example, I'll give you this as an example, the Cameron County Census Full Count Committee back in 2010. And we had an organized effort in the colonias telling people not to be counted, not to fill out the census forms, and no matter how hard we tried to get them not to do that, that's the way it was. So those numbers are an undercount. Now, with that said, let's look at this. These are the topics. Good. These are the topics that I like to discuss and touch on. I can't go into great detail on any of them, but this is what's important, okay? I want to talk about the social and economic, the political conditions in Central America, to a lesser extent in Mexico, but Mexico also, that leads to the immigration, the huge immigration of people to the border. I want to talk about the decision to immigrate. What decisions have to be made or are made by families? I mean, many of the people here in the room, myself included, many of us are parents. We're parents. We have young children, sons and daughters, 10 years old, 11, 12, even younger. What would you send your 12-year-old, 13-year-old daughter from Honduras and send her off to the United States, hoping that she would get there without being accosted, raped, beaten, robbed. I don't think I would, or you would, but at least, but many thousands of people do. So I have to place my, we have to place ourselves in the situation of those parents, and the we have to look at the desperation of those parents. That's the reality of it, that they would place their children in danger, but with the hope, and we'll talk about that, of their getting to the United States. I want to mention, I want to talk just very briefly about DAPA and DACA, the journey, the perilous journey through Mexico, getting across the river, which is probably the easiest thing to do. Getting across the river between Guatemala and Mexico is pretty easy. Getting across this river is easy. It's the 800 or 900 miles that you have to cross in Mexico to get here. That's tough. And then, if you're fortunate enough, to get here, then what? By the way, all of these notes, the PowerPoint presentation and notes, they're all available to you. At the end of my presentation, I give my email address, and if anybody would like to have them, I'll gladly send them to you, okay? Where do they come from? The majority of the unaccompanied children and mothers and children that are crossing the border into the United States are coming from these three countries. There are others, of course. And more recently, they're coming from Haiti and Cuba. But Honduras, Guatemala, and Mexico, are the three primary points of origin that they're coming from. We have to ask ourselves the question, why? The numbers, and we're going to look at the numbers in just a minute. If we look at the numbers of people who immigrated from Central America into the United States in 2010, 2005, they're nowhere near the numbers today. So what is it exactly that happened? And I think that there's a couple of things that did happen that we need to talk about. You know, when you study immigration, you talk about, your professors talk about the push factors and the pull factors. And those are all very important to examine. Those factors which push a person out of their country of origin to some other place, and those factors which pull a person out of their country of origin to the place they end up in. In reading the literature, and I've read as much of it as I can, I've been in a lot of it myself, I don't think, for whatever reason, I don't think people are the media have hit on the reasons why people are coming. And I want for us to examine those things. I mean, they say, for example, well, extreme conditions of poverty, that's true. Economic chaos and social chaos in Central America, that maybe that's true. I don't know. I don't want to say that. In Mexico, the same thing. I mean, you know, what has changed? How is Central America and Mexico any different today than they were 10, 15 years ago? I don't think that they are significantly different. Somebody might think they are. So then, is there gang activity? Is there violence? Are they threatened? Yes. Yes, they are. That's all true. But are tens of thousands of people going to flee Central America because of gangs? Well, not all of those. Some of those are, no doubt about it. But that can't possibly be the reason. I believe, you know, a large percentage of the people, of the kids and mothers who are crossing the border, in some cases men, very few, we know that they already have relatives in the United States. They have a relative in Minneapolis, in Chicago, in Houston, Dallas, wherever, in the Valley. And so they're, as I mentioned earlier, so they have a destination in mind. Also, I believe that and we know that the people of Central America have recognized with the implementation of what is called DACA and DAPA, deferred action on parents and deferred action on children, which are acts which come after the Dreamer Act. So DACA and DAPA were implemented. Let's go forward. There you have it. In 2012, by the Obama administration. And I think that the organized forces in Central America, whether it be relief agencies, churches, and other organizations, have told people that they need to take advantage of this opportunity before it changes. And that there was no guarantee what would happen, and look what has happened with the a change in the presidency in the United States. And so people have sent their children forward to the border, hoping that they could get into a DACA deferred action program for children before the immigration laws changed. And really, there are immigration laws, no doubt, but really there's more immigration policy than there is immigration law. And immigration policy is enforced arbitrarily by the region, by the enforcers and by the immigration court judges. So the way in which immigration policy is enforced in California or Arizona is very different from the way it is. It's hard to understand. How could that be? How could they have one enforcement policy in the Rio Grande Valley and another one in Arizona or California? But they do. And of course, a lot of it depends on the attitudes of the immigration judges. Okay, I went through that. We had the hint of opportunity, and this slide. In 2012 is when those programs were enacted, as I said. The intention of both was to validate individuals and families with long tenure in the United States. I guarantee that there are people in the room today that are dreamers, because I have them in my class. Some of you may have been my students. They were brought into the United States as children. They have no documentation. They are undocumented. And so the Dreamer Act was intended to provide people with opportunity, people who have been here a long time, who are now grown, who are college students or working in the community to have opportunities to have legal status. Let's look at, he gives you an example of I know that I'm trying to get through the statistics relatively fast without pounding you with them. But 35% of undocumented U.S. residents are eligible for those programs. 81% of the parent eligible persons of the United States have lived here for at least 10 years, and in many cases, as long as 20 years. The average personal income is twice the level of the poverty level. About 68% of them live above the poverty level. So what does that tell us? That tells us that these people who were and are undocumented and immigrants to the United States are being educated, they're working, they have an income that is decent, and they're just trying to raise their families. This is, if you don't know about this, this is very, very significant. There's a train, and I've been into all through Mexico and into Central America to see this, to see the pictures of what you see here. Those are not my pictures, but I've gone to see this. The so-called beast train. Literally thousands of people, and including children, climb aboard that train, usually somewhere in Chiapas, or they make it to Veracruz, and then they board the train. At each stop, there are fewer and fewer of them, because many are kidnapped, abducted, killed. And so we don't know exactly what percentage of those who start off actually make it, but it's a smaller percentage. In Mexico and in throughout Central America, there are some very serious gangs. I don't want to belabor that point here today, for one reason, because it's dangerous to do that. But there are human trafficking, you should know, and we'll leave it at that. Human trafficking has become the most lucrative business of gangs and cartels. There's more money to be made in human trafficking than there is in cocaine or methamphetamine or marijuana. And so many of the organized criminal organizations are switching their activity away from drugs and toward human trafficking. So it's become a major activity. The primary gang, and there are many gangs, okay? There are many, many gangs. The primary gang is the known as the Mara, M13, Mara Salvatrucha, which actually got its start in Los Angeles during the civil wars in Central America in the 1980s, in which immigrants from Central America had to organize and defend themselves against the Chicano gangs of East Los Angeles and other places. And then these people were deported, and then they began to organize into the gangs that we see in Central America today. But they're everywhere throughout the United States, by the way. These are the so-called, I guess, these are the so-called bad hombres that our president refers to, not to mention the cartels. Now let's look at these figures. And let me move my notes along, if I may. Okay. In 2009, Mexico accounted for 82% of the immigrant arrivals. But by 2014, Honduras, El Salvador, and Guatemala accounted for 73%. And so we've been reading about this, and we know that the number of Mexican immigrants, we know that Mexicans have been leaving the United States, and the number of Mexican immigrants coming into the United States has declined dramatically, at the same time that the number of immigrants from Central America has increased. 75% of unaccompanied children are boys. And about 85% of them are reunited with family members in an average of about 35 days. So we hear about detention, and detention is it's another ugly word. Apprehension was the first ugly word. Detention is another ugly word. But we're building detention facilities. You know our Walmart store over on South Padre Island Highway and 511. I mean, that's a detention center. I was lined up with buses when I passed by there yesterday. Another center, I assume, is the Southwestern Key Center on Elizabeth that's been completely rebuilt. If you're next to Sacred Heart Church. The majority of unaccompanied immigrant children are eligible for some kind of relief by law, including asylum. And this is why when they're sent, you know, the danger, if they could be transported somehow magically from their country, their home, their front door into the United States, then there wouldn't be any problem. But it's the problems that they encounter along the way that are so terrible. In 2011, we counted, the federal government counted about 16,000 unaccompanied children who were so-called apprehended at the border. In 2012, from 2011 to 2012, the number increased by 50% to 24,000. In 2013, it increased by 60% again to over 38, almost 39,000. And then comes 2014. 2014 is when the so-called humanitarian crisis occurred. Why it took so long for our government to discover that we had a crisis, I don't know. But in 2014, there was a 92% increase over the previous years to about 68, almost 70,000 unaccompanied immigrant children who came into the United States at the border in 2014 alone. That's when I began studying this, because I was fortunate to be invited to speak in Ciudad Victoria to a national congress there. And then this paper has been an update from 2014 to 2017. So that in 2015, 40,000 immigrant children were apprehended. Now, interestingly, that was a decline of about 40%. Why would that be? Well, because of all of the activity, because of all the media, because of all of the attention, it declined for about a year. But by 2016, it once again rose by 20,000 to 60,000, about 20,000 over the peak year of 2014. Okay. In the Rio Grande Valley, the increase in immigrant unaccompanied children increased by 178% or 37,000 in 2015. Over the same time period, as I've mentioned, the number of immigrants from Mexico has consistently declined. Okay, I'm passing up on a lot of these numbers because I can see you going crazy. Here's an example. I think it's important to talk about fear. I mentioned that, you gotta be kidding me. I mentioned he took up all my time, so I'm taking his time back. I mentioned on my Facebook page and a couple of articles in the media that talked about fear that immigrants have, and some people said, "Oh, there's no fear. They don't have anything to fear." Well, come on. I mean, how? There's a whole literature that talks about the mental health, and I'm obviously not going to. I should have assumed that I wouldn't get through all my presentation. The mental health issues associated with being an undocumented immigrant. We've been through all those numbers. There's some pictures of so-called apprehension, and then detention. All these pictures. All those pictures are on the internet. When our federal government was simply not prepared with the mass influx of people, and especially children. Our federal government and our I don't have anything bad to say about about ICE or Border Patrol or anything. Nothing bad at all. Those people are trying to do the best job they can do. But when you're faced with, 5,000 apprehensions a week and having to put them into detention, you very rapidly become overwhelmed. And they did, and they are. So not only, and then that translates, the feeling of apprehension and being overwhelmed of the federal agents is passed on, that's passed on to children. Children sense when something's not right. They sense when they're, and that's where fear comes from, and that's where all of the mental health issues that are documented come from. I'm gonna, you know, that can't be, we can't possibly do that. The border wall is the so-called border wall is incidental. Now, our federal government is getting geared up. There you have the border wall as it goes into the Pacific Ocean. You may not have ever seen that picture before. And there you have a picture of the border wall here in Brownsville, where it ends out on Highway 4. And we're told that, and I believe that the federal government is going to build several hundred miles of additional border wall. It's a total waste of money. It has, you know, the border wall does not stop. They estimate that it takes like 35 seconds for a person of, not me, but, you know, no, it'd take me, I don't think I could get over it. But for a young, agile person, 35 seconds to get over the border wall. Not to mention the problems of immigrant death. And you may not have, you've heard about this, but we estimate that 6,000 immigrants have died trying to cross, getting across the desert, getting from the Rio Grande Valley northward across the brush country. People die and we find their remains all the time. This particular one is in, I think, Arizona. Now it brings me to, I'm going through this quickly, but I want to say something about our Valley Colonias. Our four Valley counties are the four poorest counties in the United States. And the populations of the, because I study this, the population growth in our border colonias is double the growth rate of the Rio Grande Valley. Let's say your neighborhood is not growing at the rate of the colonias. And I'm not talking about Cameron Park, okay? They're pretty well healed. But many of the colonias in which, like I says there, in the 2010 census, there were 370,000 people living in colonias in six South Texas counties. People who live in colonias are extremely poor. They're marginalized. You need to understand that. They're marginalized. Imagine living without electricity. Imagine living without water. Without, you might say, well, without a telephone or a television. What good is a television? Well, that's where you get your news from. Imagine living without a computer, the digital divide. I read just in the paper today I read that the Brownsville and Spinnet School District is going to buy every fifth grader a tablet. How wonderful. What a wonderful decision. Every fifth grader in Brownsville is going to have a tablet. But the people who live, and some of those people are live in colonias, but not many. No transportation. How do you take the children to the doctor or yourself? Inadequate food, inadequate nutrition. Can't read or write. No job. No money. No public assistance. Constant fear of deportation and looming mental health issues. In case you haven't noticed, and I don't know when was the last time you drove from McAllen to Roma, or Rio Grande City, to Zapata, to Laredo. Some of you have. I mean, there is a highway, in some cases, there's a DPS officer every mile. Not to mention the Border Patrol, the ICE agents, the customs agents. The way I look at this, when we stand back and look at the big picture, and this is not counting local law enforcement, city law enforcement, county law enforcement, our Valley community has become increasingly militarized. We're living in a militarized zone. a zone in which the people who are undocumented, God bless them, are being maintained as very much the way you would keep cattle in a pen, because they can't leave. They can't go north of the checkpoint. They can't go beyond that point at Falfurrias or Sarita. So that means then that they have to live perpetually in the border. Do you know that there are so many immigrant children and undocumented immigrant children now that the court dates, because they have to assign them a court date. Every child has to be assigned an attorney, allegedly, and go before an immigration judge. You know, the dates now are 4 and 5 years out in the future. Imagine that. You're a 12-year-old kid, 9-year-old kid, and somebody gives you a piece of paper that says you have to be back in 4 years or 5 years. I mean, you don't understand that. You don't know what that's about. And the reality is that the majority of those kids are not appearing. And when they don't appear, I mean, how can we expect it for them to appear? And then when they don't appear, then they automatically go into on a list of those who are automatically to be deported. So the system is set up in such a way to defeat them and deport them and send them back, instead of helping them, send them back to where they came from. So let's look, and I'm closing. You don't have to tell me, as I'm coming to the end. The federal government must be forward-thinking in preparing for the arrival of families and children. Let's start now. Why aren't they doing that? And from the literature that I read, they still don't have a clue. Immigration reform and uniform immigration policies are desperately needed in this country. Immigration law, immigration reform, we don't have that. The militarization, as I just said, of the valley and the border is tangible and frightening. An internal colony of poor immigrants is being formed in the valley. The other, you know, my little ranchito is out on Highway 4, out on Palmetto Hill. And the other day, I mean, I've driven on Highway 4 from Four Corners out to Palmetto Hill for years and never see a soul. But last week, I saw 4 DPS cars. 4! Not to mention the immigration check station, La Garita, that's out there. So a shadow population of undocumented families is going to continue to grow in the valley. What are the implications? What will happen to our valley community? We want them to be members of our valley community, but we're not doing anything to incorporate them into our society. So they become automatically second-class citizens or third-class citizens without much hope of ever being a, it's a perpetuation of poverty. Now, I'm going to end there. I think I did pretty well. I went through about 8 pages of a 50-page presentation. There you see my email address. This PowerPoint presentation, which I made just for you, and the notes that I prepared are available to you because you're students, most of you, and I want you to have them. So if you want them, then all you have to do is email me and I'll send them to you. Okay, so our leaders here, what happens next? I mean, I'm pretty much done with, I've said what I had to say, and I thank you for paying attention. Well, I appreciate it. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Well, now we are going to introduce our panel, and you are going to have the chance to ask some questions about their presentation or immigration in general, if you want to. With our recent speaker, Tony Zavaleta, here in the table with the panel, is Sister Norma Pimentel from Caridades Católicas. If you Google her name, you will find out words like solidarity, missionary, mercy, love, and she's also known as a nun who speaks directly to the Pope. Let's welcome her. Along in the panel is from Lupe, La Unión del Pueblo Entero, Ninfa Alemán. Lupe, as we all know, it's one of the many groups in the Rio Grande Valley that won't stop fighting for immigrant rights. Even if the scenario comes very chaotic, they will never stop. And also with them is Rosalba Resendiz from UTRGV. She is an associate professor from criminal justice. Let's give her a round of applause. Also, as we know, Dr. Brian McCormack, TSC instructor of history. And our students' representatives from TSC and from UTRGV. Now, from our panel, if you want to share something with the audience, it's your turn. You can share something with them. Just feel free.
Yes, muchas gracias. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. I am very happy to be here. I think that it is very important that we hear and understand what is happening here in our valley. Aquí en el valle, somos aquí, y necesitamos saber lo que está pasando. Yo, en el 2014, fui introducida a una realidad muy triste que estábamos viviendo nosotros aquí en el valle. You know, Dr. Zavaleta said in 2014, the valley was not expecting the number of children that were coming to our valley, thousands of them. And they came here, and they didn't know what to do with them. They can't get rid of them because they had to keep them in detention until they can figure out where to put them. So I was able to go with a family, the kids that were coming with their parents. They were allowed to travel. So that's how the valley got involved and organized to help these families, these mothers, these with their infants that were at the bus stations in dire need of help. And so the valley responded with care, with love, and compassion. And we've done that to this day, up to 71,000 people that we've helped. However, back then, that very first days that I was introduced to what was happening, I asked to go to the detention facilities to a leader in the community, and I got in. This is when everything was happening and these detention facilities were packed. A facility that could only hold 300 people at one time, because it was just to process them. There was no restrooms or kitchens or anything to take care of them. And they were holding them, mostly all children. Chiquitos, 5, 10 años cuando mucho. Yep. Very small. They were all in there, dirty, muddy, crying. And they were looking through these glass windows in cells, all like little sardines, packed up. They could not lay down or sit down. There was no room. And they were not there 1 day, 2 days, 1 week, several weeks, just there waiting until we could figure out what to do. I asked to go in and see them. And they didn't want to let me go in, so I said, I would like to pray with them. So they had no choice. And they said, let her in. I could barely go in between them to get in the middle where they were. They were all around me, crying with their faces full of tears, telling me, sáqueme de aquí, por favor. Get me out of here. No puedo respirar. I can barely breathe. This little kid comes to me and says, my mom is here. Mi mamá está aquí. And I told him, if your mother's here, I'm certain you'll be out soon. We prayed, all of us. And they said with their words, Padre Nuestro, ayúdanos. And they would repeat after me every single word. And we were all crying. And out through the windows, I could see the officers looking in. And I could see that they were also moved. And as I walked out of there, my heart was torn. I couldn't believe that this was happening and that I couldn't do anything to get them out of there. The officer tells me, "Sister, thank you, because you helped us realize they're human beings." It's overwhelming to see so many kids. I realized then that I had a mission to let the world know that it was not right. Not here in the United States. We're the most powerful nation in the world. How could we have allowed that? They're children, kids. And we did not have a better option for them. So we are all called to do something, to speak up, to defend, to get rid of laws that are unjust. It is our country, and we need to do something. Thank you.
Sorry. What you said is true. My name is Nymph Aleman. I'm a community leader for Lupe. Lupe has done a lot of work for immigrants. Sorry that I'm crying, but she touched part of my life. And she said, I haven't been detained or anything, but the reason I became a member of Lupe was because I couldn't subscribe my son to school. Apparently, liaison told me that if I don't bring any ID, she was going to call the police on me, that I kidnapped my child, I was going to give my child to his father. Unfortunately, I was here illegally. The father of my child was Border Patrol. So imagine my fear and everything. Lupe saved me to go through that. It hurts. I'm sorry. Discrimination is so hard. It's an emotion that humiliates you. It makes you feel inferior. That's why I became a member of Lupe. To get better, to learn ways to help other people, not to be discriminated in such a way. And I want to thank God that I'm here. I became here at the United States when I was 17, not by choice. They brought me here. So there's a lot of confusion. They say, well, people come here because of the American dream. I don't know what is that. So I realized that I was here illegally until I was 26 because the family that brought me here, they gave me everything. I was like a little rich girl. But when you have that taken away from you, you're out in the open. It's like when you lose your parents, your family, and you don't know what to do. You realize you're here in another country, another language, another laws. It's hard, especially when you have kids. And the people that are supposed to help you is here and it's not helping you. That's why I don't understand why these laws are made. They're supposed to help, but I think they're hurting more. They're dividing this nation. They're dividing emotionally, physically, everything. And I think we have to look for a solution. That's my only opinion. Sorry.
Okay. I'm Dr. Resendiz. I teach at UTRGV Criminal Justice. I'm originally from the Valley. I grew up in Southmost, and my mom lives in Cameron Park right now. And so I actually came to school here during middle school to visit, and I actually saw Dr. Zavaleta. So I'm really happy to be here, especially because it's good to see Latinos in positions of, you know, a power in the sense where they're educators. Because seeing those kind of professors, I was able to leave the Valley and come back and share, you know, my knowledge as well. So thank you, sir, for, you know, it, so having people like that around. Now, he touched something about why there is this migration coming down. We tend to forget that when people come down here, they come from war-torn countries. El Salvador, any place in Central America, has been subjected to a lot of war. And the reasons for that has to do with the United States. The United States has meddled a lot in those countries, never allowed them to develop properly. So if you are interested in finding out more about that, you can see The Harvest of Empire. It's actually based on a book and explains how we have affected them, their countries, and what they're suffering through right now, the poverty, the instability, is due to U.S. policy, interventionist policies. So that's really important to remember. Also, people talk about how the people that come here, the children, you know, they have no right to be here. Dr. Zavaleta touched upon that as well. We forget that they are refugees. He did say that. And we forget that as the United States, we are supposed to take those children as refugees. Even people from Central America, we're supposed to take them. Why? Because we actually are part of the United Nations. As part of the United Nations, we're committed to accepting refugees from war-torn countries. So every time they have that rhetoric, you know, that they're just coming here to steal your jobs, it's the most ridiculous thing on earth. And the biggest problem with our policies today, even before, is that it's based on racism. So for those of you that voted for Trump thinking it will get better for you, for individual economic success, you really have to consider beyond yourself. Every time you vote, every time you're involved in something, it's not just about you, it's about other people. So if you know any Trump supporters, anybody that voted or doesn't think about people deserve a chance here in the United States, go learn more beyond yourself. Think about how it affects society in general. A lot of people that voted for Trump are now kind of, oh, well, we kind of messed up. Yes, you did. You were thinking about yourself. You have to think beyond that, of others. And that's really important to know that in the Latino community. Also, the idea that some people don't belong here, this is the Americas. Most of us are indigenous, regardless if we might be light-skinned or dark-skinned, we're indigenous. This land has always been ours. So when people migrate here, they're not really coming into a different country, a different land. This is all our land. So those of you that sometimes discriminate against your own people, you have to be there to help others, and it's really important. Now, the CBP... I teach a lot of students to go into Department of Homeland Security, and one of the things I always teach them is that I want people in there that are Latinos, that they understand about the actual rights and social justice. Criminal justice is not just about, you know, detaining people or arresting. It's about protecting social justice. A lot of people that go into as police officers, they are peace officers. So it's not just about security, it's about providing order and peace. And part of doing that is also protection, but to everyone, not just certain people. Now, the CBP and the DHS, some of them are pretty racist, and you have to be careful, sad to say. And some of the students that are Latinos have turned to the other side in the sense that they are racist themselves. So with this type of administration we have now, we really do need to come pull together even more now, because it's not at the federal level that they're going to help us. And as the sister said, it's like it's up to us right now locally to help each other. Anyways, I could go on forever. I teach classes about this, but I would like to invite you to the Human Trafficking Conference. We have one at SDC next week, April 5th and 6th, and we touch about a lot of these issues as well. I am the co-organizer with Jenny Clark at SDC, and it's free, it's open to the public, April 5th and 6th, and you'll probably hear the sister there. I believe she's invited to the conference this year. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hi,
hello.
We can hear you.
Okay. Well, hello. My name is Julia Baldonado. I am a student here at TSC. I am in SLA, Student Leadership. I graduated from there, the program there. I am a Student Government Association member, and my major is in criminal justice.
So good afternoon, and thank you all for being here. So my name is Abraham Diaz Alonso. I'm undocumented. I'm one of the students who have gone through this. I'm one of the many people who are part of these numbers that you may read off the newspaper, that you may see on TV. And I'm the reality. I am the living proof of what's going on and the reason why people migrate from one place to another. It's not because we want to. It's not because we just decide to move from one home to another. It's because there is need. There is oppression, there is hunger, there's lack of jobs, there's different things that are factors in this on why we migrate. Myself, I'm part of Minority Affairs Council. It's a student organization that was founded by undocumented students at the University of Texas Pan American then. We're now at UTRGV. UTRGV has the most undocumented students in the state of Texas with over 950, wow, including myself. With this high number, there is a need. It's something big. We're bigger than other universities across the state. We're students who came here like myself. I came at the age of 8 to the US. I was brought. It's the story that you hear. I wasn't given a choice to come. I'm a student, should be graduating this May with my bachelor's, and it's been a struggle. It's been a struggle because I was a student that was sitting with you in high school. I was a student that was playing sports against you in the rival team. I was that same student that was eating the same lunch as you. I'm that student. And the reality is that there's so many obstacles that I have to go through just to get to where you're at. The only difference between me and you is a 9-digit social security number. That's the only thing that's different between me and you. I don't have that same opportunity to be able to get that job, that scholarship, that financial assistance, different things because of that 9 number. And the purpose of Minority Affairs Council, we were started because in Mission, Texas, one of the dreamers that was graduated from La Jolla committed suicide because he thought that because he was undocumented, he couldn't go on to college, which is a lie. Texas has laws that allows any student, whether they're undocumented, documented because of their race, sexuality, anything, to go on to college. They have the same equal opportunity since 2001. There are states in the US now that do not allow students who are undocumented to go on to college. And if they do, then they make it practically impossible by paying thousands of dollars, over $10,000, $20,000 per semester just to attend. And this is the reality that we have to live as undocumented. I don't come from that family who founded maybe the Rio Grande Valley or who's been through generations in the US. I'm that family who had to migrate because of struggles. And the purpose that we do is, whenever the unaccompanied minor situation came up in 2014, we were there because we know the struggles that these students, that these families, that these kids were going through because we lived them firsthand. We were there to assist, we were there to help with anything we could because we could relate firsthand. One of the things that is that Minority Affairs Council throughout, I guess, my college years has taught me is to love one another and to protect each other. And that the only thing that I have to lose is my chains. So anything that I do just coming here is putting myself at risk. But knowing that I'm letting hundreds of students know about the struggles, about the reality, is more than worth it. Because it's not just about me. It's about the entire community in the Rio Grande Valley. Thank you.
Now we still have a little time for questions. I don't know, in the public, who wants to go first? The mics are here in front, so you can... No? Nobody?
Don't be mad.
Yeah.
good evening. That's in Nahuatl. This goes to Dr. Zavaleta.
Yes.
You're an anthropology, retired anthropology professor.
Yes.
My question to you, sir, is by any chance in the future, do you see ourselves reclaiming our roots, our indigenous roots, not calling ourselves Latinos, right? Because that comes from Spain, Italy, Portuguese, Southern Europe, right? Hispanics, Spain, right? So we're not, of course, like the doctor over here.
It's okay, don't worry. Yeah.
McCormick.
Yeah, Dr. Descendiz, I apologize. She said it herself, we do have indigenous roots, right? So when do you see, of course, if it's possible for us to reclaim our indigenous identities? Because that is one of my main concerns here. There is a lot of course ignorance. They think of indigenous to be primitive, but we're not, right? For example, the Mayans, they were the first civilizations to use or utilize the number zero, right? We practice brain surgery, or my ancestor, sorry. My indigenous ancestor practiced brain surgery. We had political systems equivalent to the U.S. We're talking legislative, judicial, and of course the executive, right? Again, kind of similar to the U.S. So when do you see by any chance if the future, maybe this generation will reclaim our indigenous identities that was, of course, stolen by the colonial experiment based on Europe.
I don't know how to turn this thing on, or if it's on, maybe it's on already. I admire you. I want you to know that. Mm-hmm. And I want you to know that back in July, I had did my DNA test, and when the results came back, I'm a mutt, okay? I'm from everywhere.
I think we all are.
I'm very proud to tell you that I have 15% of what you see is Native American.
Indigenous, yeah.
Absolutely, and that's a significant percentage. And I can tell you that, I'm going to be 70 years old next month. And all through my life, especially being in anthropology and researching anthropology, I have been not only attracted to Native American movements, I've participated in Native American movements and taught courses that were not taught before. I don't, the operative word that you use is reclaim.
Yeah.
I don't think there's any reclaiming to be done. I think that we individually, you and me and our students and our friends, have to take pride and understand as much as we can about our background and our heritage and where we come from and be proud of that. I mean, I had to learn to speak a native language in order to get my doctoral degree, and I was fluent.
Wow.
I'm not today, but I was at that time in that language. I was so fluent that I was recruited by the CIA. Yeah, the CIA knocked on my door. They wanted to know. They knew I had taken a native language. They wanted to know if I wanted to join them. I'm happy to tell you I didn't do that. I came to work at Texas Southmost College. So I think that we, having organizing groups and having pláticas and discussion groups and learning as much as we can about our and participating in our heritage is what we can do. And little by little, I mean, I've seen, I've lived through 50 years of as an adult of it, but I mean, there's been some change, but not that much. But I passed the baton to you, mm-hmm. and your generation to continue on. That's all I can say about it.
And of course, what advice would you give? Because I'm thinking between taking anthropology or I don't know what type of degree, but I am deeply interested in anthropology because I do see a lot of work to be done, right? I do get disappointed that we have the opportunity to learn different languages Italian, German, Spanish, Portuguese, French, but I see the problem here with colonialism that still exists today, that we don't happen to have the opportunities to learn our native language, whether it be Nahuatl, Mayan, Purépecha, Navajo, Craig. I could go on with this. And the same thing goes with our history, too. So that's the problem that I do see here. And again, I don't see anyone standing
I think we should be, at this point in time, I think we should be concerned about the growing colonialism in the valley. Mm-hmm. And that's why I pointed out the militarization and the colonialism and what's happening to these children and these families who are immigrating from Mexico and Central America. They are automatically going into the lowest level of our society, into a caste, mm-hmm. a caste system from which there's no escape. So what future do they have? And that is modern colonialism. Mm-hmm. Our government is producing and perpetuating colonialism right here in the valley right now.
Something to add, actually.
Okay.
There is a whole new movement called decolonization, decoloniality. It's been around for decades, but it's finally coming to the forefront in indigeneity studies, and there's some really good programs, even in Canada, all the way down, you know, in the United States. So if you want more information about it, you can just email me about that. Actually, we're planning to do a kind of research panel conference about that, indigeneity researchers. So it is a growing. So there's a different fields you can go into now. So you just don't have to kind of get stuck to one. So that's a really cool. And the whole idea of militarization, coloniality, it is very true, even in academics, specifically in academics, so yeah.
Yeah, we started to see, of course, a growing problem between police state. Who knows if we're ever going to be turning to a martial law.
But the thing about, we've always had a police state. This was colonized. The indigenous people here were colonized always. We've always had to deal with this, always, you know, so it's kind of sad that we've actually had a militarized zone always, you know. Since
But
thank you so much. We have to give time to another question.
Thank you for your comment.
Hello, my name is Luis, and my question is addressed to everyone. So if you would like to answer, please go ahead and answer if you feel the reason or you have the answer for what I'm going to ask. As far as the audience, I always think about this whenever I see motivation, right, as far as pro-immigration reform and everything like that. And then me, I'm inspired, and, you know, I feel what you guys say, especially, like, testimonies and everything like that. And I'm sure plenty of people here feel that, right? My thing is, what do we focus on from here on out? So, for example, after today or after this hour or 2 hours, how do we make the most out of it? Or what can you guys say where we make the most out of it as far as what we can do from our side? As far as, you know, the general person hearing what you're saying, what is what we can do united, or what you recommend from experience that has worked, where we can contribute to the community or put ourselves in a position where we actually impact in a positive way our local community, where it goes to state, federal, or anything like that. Our RH, right, as far as college, where you make it relevant to us, where we can connect maybe with other communities, but how we actually make the impact, not just feel motivated, you know, and leave here like, oh, you know, this is a great point, but nothing, we don't have that action or plan to follow as far as to make something happen from our side. So that's something I'm interested in. If I have a clear plan, I feel like I could really follow it, especially if people here have the motivation. You give them a clear plan with the motivation that really starts to get things going. And I know facts and information is one thing, but having somewhere to take it or somewhere to go to make it more reasonable as far as the impact, I think that's what I'm looking for the answer if you're willing to have one.
Sorry. Well, I can tell you what I learned from students from other universities. I have some meetings with them and everything, and I learned a lot about them. The only limit is yourself. You need to research, you need to look. Whatever your passion is, you need to go through it. And surround by people that have the same ideals. Don't get with negative people because they're gonna tell you, don't do this, oh, it's not worth it, don't do that. Because you wanna make a difference, you look what you really wanna make a difference in and what. There's a lot of agencies, you have the internet. One word, a lot of things come up. This Saturday, April the 1st, there's going to be a march celebrating Cesar Chavez in San Juan. If you want to participate, There's going to be a lot of people there, a lot of students. You can get information from a lot of agencies. And I'm here in this agency because I'm a volunteer in different agencies. One of the march opened my eyes, the reality of what immigration is about. I was blind. I was living in my own world. But when they invite me to one of those march and I saw different people. So it's not identity, it's you. You are the one who makes the difference.
Mm-hmm. So your point
I just want to add to something that is important is that what is happening today in our time is dehumanization and it's caused by indifference. We need to get involved mm-hmm. in any way you can.
Yeah.
Respect. Don't look at who are you from or where is your language, not respect, because respect is going to open the doors for everything.
I noticed in the newspaper that there's going to be a commemoration. I think Lupa is doing it.
Yes.
A commemoration of the farm worker strike of 1966. Yeah, I was there, and I'm very proud to tell you that it was a Saturday morning. I was a Texas Southmost College student in 1966, and the bus picked us up right out here by the Tandy building, there were about 10 of us, and took us to the La Casita Farms, where I saw a Texas Ranger shoot dead a farm worker for no other reason than he could do it, and knew that no one would say anything to him, and I was there that day. And so I'd say to you and all of you, the way you keep this movement going is by first and foremost, registering to vote and participating and forming a club. You know, I was looking at the forms. They're not so hard to fill out, the forms at Texas Southmost College or UTRGV, to form an organization for culture or for whatever. And you could do that. You could be a leader in that. Thank you.
Thank you. That helps as far as that. And I hope a lot of people get a lot from it. Do you guys have, I know he put his email up, and I know a lot of people, you know, you're really involved as far as that's why you're there. Would you guys also be comfortable having like some sort of outreach, maybe your Facebook group or anything like that? So if maybe people don't feel comfortable now to ask you a question, there would be a lot of benefit for them to ask you maybe on their own time, and then they get the answer, and you know, that really spreads it a little bit more, makes it more personal and more powerful. And also for me, like I like to have that, so I could do that, what I'm saying, so.
Thank you so much. We have another question right here.
One of the reasons we have this diverse panel of people is so that we can begin that process networking. I think you can also start at, you know, the community level and our campus, both our campus, reaching out to UTRGV as well, and building from there. So, you know, come up and talk to us afterwards, and we'll exchange information and see, you know, anyone else who'd like to kind of be involved in that way. And that's why we have this panel. We want to kind of put together people from diverse organizations, agencies, and students from across the valley who want to get involved and address these issues, because I think what Sister Pimentel is saying is very true. This is a humanitarian issue, and a lot of times we study our history and we say, well, how did this happen back then? How did people sit back and allow groups of people to be dehumanized and treated the way they were treated? And you know, we get desensitized to the kinds of things that are occurring and happening, you know, right in our own communities. So that's what we want to kind of begin focusing on, empowering each other and supporting each other in that effort.
Thank you so much. Now, your question.
Thank you. No problem. Well, first I'd like to comment something, please. Thank you for being here at the panel, Dr. Zavaleta, everybody who's up here. And I don't know if Sister Pimentel will be joining us or if she is gone now, but her efforts are appreciated. Abraham, your story resonates with me and with so many others. Although there's a huge age difference between us, I, like you, at age 6 was brought over by my parents, totally different circumstances and so long ago. But I applaud you for having assimilated and adopting the behaviors, traditions, and all the things that come with the culture here. And I think that your case is the situation for the overwhelming majority of the people that are brought as young children. However, there is a fraction of the population that seemingly does not want to do just that, assimilate and adopt the customs, traditions, and the law of the land. I tell you that because, as Dr. Zavaleta just mentioned, the newspapers tells us a lot about what's happening, you know, worldwide, nationally, and even locally. So I'd like to see if anyone in the panel can acknowledge the frustrations of some people of a small population. I know tonight's topic is about unaccompanied minors, but a small population of the undocumented people who have committed crimes that have impacted the lives of citizens and or residents here. I personally accompanied last month someone that went through a trial that involved the murder of her partner and decapitation here in our Laguna Madre, and it involved four undocumented people from Mexico and Honduras. And I think that that leaves a taste in the mouths of a lot of people, and I think that that's one big reason why we have the administration we have now. And I'd like to see if anyone has a comment on those things.
Who wants to answer that?
Yeah. So one of the things is, what is the definition of being American? I'm pretty sure there's not one definition. If you were to say, define American, some might say English, some might say light skin, dark skin, brown skin, yellow skin, different things. There's not one definition of being American. And as far as maybe some people do accommodate themselves to the culture, to the language, to the traditions, to many things, to be able to overcome some of the obstacles that are, I mean, thrown at us.
One of the things I would define as an American, Abraham, is doing what you're just doing. You know, you've English probably comes more natural to you now, and it's taken effort and a long time. But that would be a starting point there.
Right. So in the U.S., we don't only speak English. We do speak French, Spanish, German, Italian, many languages. It's not just one. It's not just English. It's not just Spanish. It's not just German. It's not just Russian. There's so many of the languages that being multilingual is actually a good thing. It's actually a better thing. And as far as committing crimes, seeing immigrants committing crimes, nobody ever, ever wants to promote committing a crime, ever. Whether you're a U.S. citizen, a U.S. permanent legal resident, whether you're undocumented, whether you're on a visa, on a work visa, we never, ever promote. And it's not the purpose of undocumented immigrants to come here to commit crimes. You're never with a mentality of saying, you know what, I'm gonna go into the U.S. to commit 10 crimes, one crime, kill someone, do fraud, rob a store, do anything. Never, ever in the mind of an immigrant is that purpose. So now uplifting these stories of this person killed a certain person because he's an immigrant, that is not the reason. And that's the story that we cannot focus on. It's like saying all the immigrants in the U.S., over 11 million immigrants, are college graduates. We cannot uplift that because, one, it's not true, and two, it's just uplifting one reasoning that doesn't resonate with everybody else. So it's not the same thing that saying, let me compare Abraham's story of how he was able to overcome the different obstacles that were given through him and thrown to him in college, in high school, in elementary, to one of a criminal. It's not the same thing to uplift one story and not the rest, especially when it's a very fraction percentage of less than 4%.
Thank you, Abraham.
Thank
just
you
one
so
last
much.
Thing.
We
please.
Have one only last time thing. For one
Sister
more
Pimentel,
question there.
She touched the lives of 71,000 youths, minors, I take it, and that is commendable. But think of how that is going to inspire hundreds of thousands, perhaps millions, dare I say, of other families to do the same with their children. And if we are overwhelmed now, are we ready for what may still come as a result of the information that they, you know, these respective countries are getting on the humanitarian efforts that are being done here?
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Our last question.
Hello, good evening. I don't have a question, just a comment on words like Dr. Zavaleta had mentioned on apprehensions and detentions.
Can you get close to the microphone? I can't hear you.
Yes. How can you refer to programs such as Southwest Keys, BCFS, IES as detention centers when these are programs funded by ORR, which help the youth? It's not much of a detention center. They're housed, they're sheltered, they're counseled, they're giving medical assistance, they are educated as well. It just makes it seem like it's a negative term to use for programs that help. A lot of the times kids come and it's a safe haven
absolutely,
for them.
Absolutely, you're absolutely correct. I have every respect for Southwest Key, and Juan Sanchez has been a friend of mine since the 1970s, and I know that everything you're saying is accurate in terms of the services that are provided. I didn't mean that. I didn't mean to include it as just another detention center, and I apologize if it was taken that way.
That was my only comment. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, everybody, for participating today. I will ask for another round of applause for our great panel. Each of every one of them is fighting on their own fields. So let's keep up the good work. And thank you so much for everybody to be here.